International Day. First ever. So, just wanted you to know, just like last month, this day was fully planned, fully prepared, and fully run by your peers, the students in the school. They did everything. Welcome to our first ever International Day. First ever. So, just like last month, we hope that you enjoy the presentation. I ask you to be respectful the same way you would with anybody presenting, right? And sit back and enjoy the next 40 minutes. And now I'd like to welcome the organizers, the MCs of our event.
My name is Jada.
And I'm Natalie.
And welcome to International Day. This is our first International Day here at Strath Haven. Hopefully it will not be our last.
You're right. It is so important to celebrate your own culture and others. School is not just about writing essays and taking tests, but building a community.
A community built on appreciation, tolerance, and growth. Keep in mind this entire assembly is student-led, so give love to your peers. We will be sitting right over there. We shouldn't be able to hear ourselves think.
And with that, don't you think we should start?
Yeah. Okay. So, our first presentation is on Jewish culture. Here to talk, please welcome Hannah Jarvis, Meredith Seidman, and Carolyn Eskenazi.
Hi everyone, I'm Meredith and I use she, her pronouns.
I'm Hannah, I use she, her pronouns.
And I'm Carolyn and I use he, her pronouns.
Today for International Day, we're going to share some information about Jewish culture. For starters, when people typically think of Jewish, they often think of negative stereotypes, as in all Jewish people are white or they have bigger noses.
But that is not true, as there is not just one image of a Jewish person. For example, all of these people have Jewish heritage or practice Judaism in some way.
There are three main sub-ethnic groups of Judaism: Ashkenazi, Sephardic or Sephardi, and Mizrahi, but we will be talking about some others as well.
First is Ashkenazi, which Hannah and I are. Ashkenazi Jewish people come from Eastern Europe, mostly countries that were part of the former Soviet Union, like Germany, Poland, and France. A majority of the Jewish population in America are Ashkenazi because of immigration in the 1900s. That's typically why you think of a white person when you think of the word Jewish. Traditional aspects mostly revolve around food, specifically matzah balls, latkes, and gefilte fish. There is some traditional clothing, like the shirtchamel, a fur hat, and the tichel, which is a scarf covering that women would wear on their heads. Additionally, like all Jewish people, we wear kippahs, a tallit or prayer shawl, which is worn while in synagogue, and Orthodox Jewish people wear more modest clothing. You'll see a picture of the movie Fiddler on the Roof on the screen, because that movie does portray an Ashkenazi Jewish family in Russia.
It's a good movie, by the way, if you haven't seen it. It's only like 3 hours, but still good.
The next group is Sephardi, which I am part of, and Latin American. We have decided to put these two groups together because a part of Sephardi Jews come from Western Europe, or Spain and Portugal, and many Latin American Jews are descended from those immigrants. Sephardi Jews used to speak a language called Ladino, also known as Judeo-Spanish, which is a mix of ancient Spanish and Hebrew. Unfortunately, that language has also almost become extinct due to forced assimilation in Spain and after being expelled. They also come from places along the Mediterranean, including North Africa and Turkey. Traditional foods include Jewish versions of classic North African dishes, such as kreme, pictured above, which is a common Shabbat dish of fish cooked in tomato sauce. There's also muflera, a sort of crepe but thinner, and kibbeh, a meat-stuffed fried dumpling. Sephardi foods also differ from Ashkenazi diets, as Sephardi Jews typically eat rice during Passover. The traditional clothing includes hats for men and women, like the sheshiyah, a higher type of kippah men would wear, and kalmah, hats for women, which were cone-shaped and have fabric coming out the top.
Moving on to Latin America, Jewish people reside in all the countries highlighted on the map above. Most Jews in Central and South America come from either Sephardic immigrants who came over during the colonization of those continents, or from Ashkenazi immigrants who came over during the Holocaust and after seeking asylum. For this reason, there is a large mix of Jewish people in Central and South America. There is no defined culture throughout Latin American Jewry. Each community has their own traditions, foods, clothing, and holiday celebrations. This is what makes Latin American Jewish people so unique and inspiring. Some fun facts about Sephardi and Latin American Jews. The first Jewish Disney princess, Princess Rebecca from the show Elena of Avalor, is a Sephardi Jew, as well as the character Kronk from The Emperor's New Groove is Jewish and believed to be descended from Sephardi crypto-Jews, which were Jewish people who had to hide their identity due to Christianity.
Next is Mizrahi and the Arabian Peninsula, which is what Jewish people from, you guessed it, the Middle East and the Arabian Peninsula are called. While Mizrahi Jews are originally from all over the Middle East and Western Asia, almost all of them now live in Israel. Their traditional food is a mix of usual Jewish cuisine and the food of the countries their families lived in for centuries before. Traditional dishes include abgush, picture above, a type of vegetable and beef stew. There's also gourmet sabzi, a lamb stew, and kereshet beznijan, a chicken stew. Traditional Mizrahi clothing is harder to pinpoint as the Jewish people living in those countries commonly adapted aspects of those cultures as well. That's why in the images above, you see the Mizrahi Jews wearing head coverings associated with Jewish culture, but in the image on the right, the man is wearing common wedding attire for Yemen. However, the sudra is a type of Jewish head wrap that Mizrahi men typically wear, and you can see the men in the picture on the left wearing one. Finally, we will share a bit on Ethiopian South and Central Asian Jews. While they are all important in their own way, we will focus on Ethiopian Jewish holiday known as Sikh. It is 50 days after the Ashkenazi holiday of Yom Kippur and celebrates accepting Torah and yearning for Yisrael in the temple. It includes fasting, reading from the Ethiopian scriptures and other prayers, and ends in a midday feast and dancing. Ethiopian Jews are the only ones who celebrate this holiday. And while we did not go into detail on these groups, we hope you look into these groups and their traditions yourselves, as they're also very important. If you want to find out more information about Jewish culture or any of the sub-ethnic groups, myjewishlearning.com is an amazing website to go check out.
Hopefully you learned a good amount about the variation in Jewish culture that and Jewish people do not have one definite image. Thank you for listening and enjoy the rest of today's presentation.
That was good, right? Well, we're just getting started. So the dance team will now be performing a dance titled All Things Afro. Give it up for Daphne Lee, Amelia Andrews, Iseta Konay, and Amaya Wade.
Oh, Maria, Maria.
little more cheer. Come on.
Will be performing two Italian songs that they plan to perform on their trip to Italy.
They're going to Italy?
Yep.
So basically, the Silvertones are here to remind us that they're going to Italy and we are not.
Good afternoon, everyone, or morning. Okay, good morning. We are the Silvertones of Strath, and for today's celebration of international culture, we will be representing Italy as artistic ambassadors of their heritage and ancient culture. We'll be singing two songs, the first of which being O Occhi Manzo Mia, which translates to O Eyes of My Beloved, and it's a beautiful love song that really captures old Italian heritage and just like the bliss of living. That's the first one. And the second one is one of our personal favorites. It's called Il Bianque Dolce Cigno, which translates to the white sweet swan. And it's another love song about the love of life and then also finding meaning and beauty in death. So thank you so much to the organizers of this. Everything has been amazing. We are honored to be a part of it. We hope you enjoy it.
Thank you.
again, we're going to need a lot of energy. Next up, we have Asia Haven and Asha Padme. We'll be performing traditional, inspired, and modern pop dances from different Asian cultures.
Thank you.
Can we give them another round of applause? Next up, we have Fraser Sudarsan giving us a speech titled, Say It Right.
Let's go, Fraser.
The only thing worse than Disney adults are the people who run straight to Harry Potter World at Universal.
Yes!
Which one? But especially you band kids. Like, what were those Instagram posts about? And the worst part is, half of you aren't even real fans. I bet you can't even say Lord Voldemort's name right. Think I just said Lord Voldemort? That's right, right? Wrong. He's actually French, so it's pronounced Lord Voldemort, without a T. Sure, he's a villain, so it's probably okay to disrespect him now and then, but my concern is that we've become too comfortable with avoiding saying names properly outside of the wizarding world. Names are a source of identity, but we've dismissed their importance, and thus they've become a source of discrimination. If you've ever thought that it would be easier for Tianyi to go by Tina, you're adding to the societal pressure for minorities to anglicize their name, thus erasing a part of their identity. So today, let's take a look at how our names shape our social identity. Discuss how by avoiding our usage of names, we're avoiding our usage of humanity. And finally, learn how to pronounce names to a T. And say Lord Voldemort without a T. I've been to many a museum, but I haven't seen a single museum gift shop have anything with my name on it. Shocking, I know. The privilege of having a normal English name transcends the gift shops at museums. Our names are the first things that people know about us. So they carry the power of shaping our social identity. A New York University study found that we have a more positive view of people who have easier to pronounce names. The entertainment industry makes it clear that this name privilege extends far beyond just pronunciation. Comedian Hasan Minhaj points out that there's a double standard when it comes to difficult names. We say Timothy Chalamet and Burlington Coat Factory, Benedict Cumberbatch with ease. But when it comes to Hasan Minhaj, we don't take the time to pronounce it right. According to the BBC, people with ethnic names have to apply for 60% more jobs than people with normal names because their application often gets rejected solely on the basis of their name. In August 2018, at least 20 women got an email from the St. Louis Mentality Health Center saying that they were denied because they wouldn't hire people with ghetto names. When we don't value a name, when we forget its importance, we let our prejudices take over, and we overlook people's talents. This difficulty to achieve success with an ethnic-sounding name leads many people to anglicize the name. Catherine Chenzia Choi, professor of ethnic studies at UC Berkeley, emphasized that the anglicization of ethnic names stems from a history of pinning foreign cultures as strange. Changing your name can be a powerful way of changing your identity and really owning it. But this isn't the case when people are forced to change their names. Laney College student, Phuc Bui, was told by her math professor that she should change her name because it sounds too much like an American insult. He knew what he was saying was offensive, but he thought that her name was worse. Like this teacher, many of us prioritize our comfort over another culture. I've been dealing with mispronunciations of my life, my name, for my entire life. And after a point, I got to the realization that it was my fault for having a difficult name, and it wasn't the other people's fault for butchering it. But I realize now that I am worth it. And it's not that I was never worth it, but that English-speaking society decided that non-English names don't deserve respect. We need to be able to look at names of all languages and not be afraid of them. We need to keep in mind that English isn't the only language spoken here in Wallingford. Our school is a melting pot of cultures and languages. Names serve as an important reminder of that. So it's important that they deserve the respect, and we treat them with that deserved respect. Instead of trying to pronounce someone's name and butchering it, ask them how to say it. It shows that you appreciate their name and their culture, and are making an effort to learn about them. Knowing people's names creates a connection, and more importantly, it helps create a more inclusive environment. My name is a part of who I am. It doesn't need a warning before it's said. It's not a curse. My name isn't, "I'm sorry if I mispronounce this." It's Supraja Sudarsan.
Next up, a few students will be showcasing their cultural wear in a runway titled Cultural Fabric.
Daphne Lee is a model herself and proposed this idea to Joyce in hope that Strath Haven students would find solace by having the chance to showcase part of their culture to their peers.
She decided to categorize the students by region so that one song special to that group could be played.
Daphne specifically said, "This is about building a community and trust in one another. We hope you enjoy."
you everyone for the wonderful performances and speeches. My name is Iris, and in relation to cultural unity, Aditi, Hannah, Anna, and I wanted to introduce the Ukraine fundraiser. Our mission is to support those who are going through tough times because of the conflict that is occurring between Russia and Ukraine. We as a school are going to raise awareness and support them through financial aid. We hope that everyone will be willing to participate in events such as bake sales and class competitions to support the cause.
As you all know, the conflict in Ukraine has affected the lives of many civilians with destroyed housing and even food shortages. As kids, we see that it's important to support other kids who are suffering in a terrible situation. Our fundraiser will be supporting UNICEF Ukraine, which is a reliable organization that will help provide relief and fund housing for Ukrainian children.
Our first fundraiser will be selling candy eggs at lunch from Thursday, March 31st to Tuesday, April 5th. They will be handed out in first block on the Friday before spring break, and you can look forward to many possible future fundraisers, including a multicultural bake sale, a dodgeball competition in fifth block, Rita's sales at baseball and softball games, and more. We hope you understand the severity of this conflict and will contribute to helping the cause. Thank you.
Since like last year, I would say. I talked to Miss Anoni and presented this idea, and she helped me along the way. Thank you so much for Miss Anoni, Dr. Hilden, Mr. Z for helping us with the way, and definitely a big thank you to all the performers. We wouldn't have been able to do without them. So.
I just want to say thank you everyone for coming. It's important that we talk about unity and diversity in our school. And even though it's the first time we do this, I hope we can see it in the future. Looking at you junior, sophomores, and freshmen. Please carry it on, and I hope we can see it next time. But that's pretty much it. Everyone have a good day and go